October 10th, 2016. My co-host today is Zachary Quinto.
What a joy to be here. Thanks for having me.
I mean, we've never done this together.
No, we haven't. It's my first time.
I feel like we've done this together at dinner parties, but never in front of a camera.
That's right.
Yeah.
Exactly. We've gotten in, we've hung out, but this is the first time that I get to, like, be here with you.
I know.
In this capacity.
Does it feel weird?
I feel like I've always, when I've been on the show with other guests, I've always been with other hosts, I've always been a little bit like, I want to do that.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, I'm so
glad. Last time I was here, I just said so, and then I fought for it, so I'm thrilled to be here.
Yeah, you finally made the cut.
I did, thank you.
And I saw your dog backstage.
But when I was here last time, I left with a dog.
Yeah, he adopted a dog. You know, we sometimes do dog segments where all of the dogs are up for adoption, and Zachary...
You didn't tell me that. When I came last time, they were like, bring your dogs, because we're doing a dog segment. I have two dogs. I had two dogs already. Mm-hmm. And so they were like, bring your dogs. And I brought them. They didn't tell me that you had like seven dogs or something up for adoption.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I just took one.
I know you did.
So now I have three.
And the dog, I'm not kidding, the dog is backstage smoking a cigar. The dog is like... Dreams do come true. I was in the system.
He was.
And they gathered a bunch of us to take us on television.
And now he's going to be back on
television. Zachary Quinto was there promoting his film. He saw me, we locked eyes, and the rest is history.
History.
And he's having caviar
right now.
He's
having caviar.
It's amazing.
Cigars and caviar.
Yeah, I always have a theory about dogs that are adopted by celebrities. Like, they know.
I think all dogs that are adopted know.
They all know, right? That they've been taken out of the system, but I think dogs, when you show up, they're like, what?
They're like, this is the life.
Zach Quinto?
I never imagined.
I mean, I never imagined this could happen.
I love Star Trek.
Right, I love Star Trek.
And now I get to live with Spock.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's amazing.
Totally.
So, some things in the news, very interesting things in the news, because I don't know if you eat spinach. Some people have a visceral reaction to spinach. Like, have you ever tried to feed Anderson Cooper spinach?
I've never tried to do that.
I have, and it's very, what he does is...
tried to feed him spinach.
He doesn't like to be rude, because he... grew up very proper and fancy, so he is not rude. He's excessively polite. So whenever he comes over for dinner, I always cook him spinach because I think he needs leafy green vegetables. I think it would just help him in general. And he'll put it on his plate, and what he'll do is he'll cover it with other food.
Oh, yeah.
So that you don't know that it's not being
eaten. It's a good technique.
But what, I love spinach. It's one of the staples of my diet. But I always get this weird feeling on my teeth after I eat spinach. Yeah, anybody else? The spinach teeth.
Sweater teeth.
Sweater teeth.
Right.
Like your teeth are wearing a sweater.
Mm-hmm.
They're saying that gritty film covering your teeth is a phenomenon called spinach tooth. It's because the leafy greens are chock full of oxalic acid.
Oxalic.
Have you heard of oxalic acid? No. Well, you're welcome. It's a naturally occurring chemical found in many plants, but spinach tends to have a higher amount of it. And they say it's a defense mechanism to prevent you from... It doesn't want to go down, apparently. It's like, no! No!
So your body is like a child with spinach? Like, your body doesn't want it? Or your teeth don't want it?
The spinach does not want to be eaten. The spinach is like, don't eat me.
Do you understand? Oh, it's a... Yes. I see. I thought it was your body's defense mechanism.
No.
It's the spinach's defense mechanism.
The spinach is trying to prevent you from eating it.
Okay.
So, here's the way to prevent spinach tooth. You squirt the lemon on top of the spinach, and it cuts the spinach tooth in half.
Wow.
Yes.
So only your bottom teeth have spinach tooth then.
Right.
If you squirt lemon on it.
If you squirt a little lemon.
It cuts it in half.
It cuts it in half. Get it?
Well,
but, you know, I never really thought about my food being alive until I saw a movie called Sausage Party, which...
See that movie?
It turns out is not a kid's film.
Did you take your kids?
No, I didn't take my kids, but I was this close. And I really... glad I did not, because it is not a children's film.
Yeah,
as funny
that.
And as imaginative as it is, it's not for kids. So if your children are telling you it's a kid's animated film, it is an animated film.
For adults.
For grown-ups. Grown-ups,
totally.
Yeah.
I saw a newsflash that that was all about the words that we are mispronouncing.
Oh, gosh. I mispronounce
everything. Some guy wrote a book And a lot of it has to do with food. But he was specific. The title is called "You're Pronouncing Moet, the Champagne." You know,
yeah.
M-O-E-T.
Yeah.
People say Moet.
Oh.
It's wrong.
Moet.
You're pronouncing it wrong. And then he goes on to say, like what, for example, is the pasta that is made of potatoes?
Gnocchi.
Gnocchi. That's right. Some people say gnocchi or gnocchi.
Gnocchi. Right. I've heard that.
Okay. What about
gnocchi? I've heard
gnocchi. Yeah. Yeah. What about when you get a Greek sandwich that's in pita bread with lamb?
Oh, is that a gyro?
See, I would say gyro, but it's actually
gyro.
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 Like year, like the year.
Gyro.
Oh.
Gyro.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then what about? Oh, this is a good one because I knew this one. But the grain that's very popular now—it's like
quinoa.
Oh yeah,
quinoa.
They were saying that people say quinoa.
Have you ever heard that?
Have you guys ever heard
people say quinoa?
You have. Guys, how about my food knowledge? Just describe.
It's a very food-oriented news segment.
What else? Give me another one.
We got some, you want the more food things?
Yeah. I just want to do one more.
Okay, one more is, it's a well-known Vietnamese noodle dish. It's spelled P-H-O.
Oh, pho?
Pho.
Pho?
Pho.
But no, because there's a noodle shop in Beverly Hills called Beverly Hills 9021 Pho.
It's true. It's true. They get real creative with the name.
Yeah, they do.
But it's actually Beverly Hills 9021 Pho.
Oh my gosh, but that's...
It loses its ring,
so
actually,
awful.
If you really correctly pronounce it.
Guys, we gotta get home. We gotta watch the new episode of Beverly Hills 9021
Pho. Oh yeah, right, you take the piece.
Right?
But yeah.
Yeah. But I thought that was such a creative... That's why I thought it was Pho, because it's 9021, and they have chopsticks.
There's other really good ones in L.A. L.A. has a lot of really good...
They
I can't
do.
Think of any of the other creative names now.
I can't either.
There's a lot of them.
They have a lot. Yeah, they do.
It's good out there in L.A. They like their Pho.
Do you spend time there?
I do. I lived there for 12 years.
How did you like it?
I love L.A.
It's nice there.
It's good. Yeah. I mean... You can't really compare the two cities to me. New York has such a different kind of vitality.
Yeah.
But L.A., the great thing, right? But the great thing about L.A. is, you know, you can get in your car and you can be at the beach or in the mountains or in the desert or, you know, like the environments that you can find yourself in are so varied. Whereas here, it's like you're in the city. Or you're, you know, in traffic to get out of the city.
Right.
And
everything here is weather permitting, whereas in LA, nothing
it's
is weather permitting
because nice.
it's always sunny.
Yeah, I moved here about 4 years ago, and I miss aspects of LA.
But you're happy.
I love it here.
You seem like a New Yorker to me too.
People say that to me a lot, and even though I lived in LA for like over a decade, but you seem like a New Yorker too.
Thanks.
Yeah, it's a compliment,
I
right?
I am a New Yorker.
Yeah.
I was the person in LA walking with people, and I walk everywhere.
I like to walk too. I will say the thing is,
people you know, are like, I Tyler Perry, Oprah's friend Tyler. who will be here tomorrow, pulled up next to me and said, "You can't walk here."
Right.
We were both at the same spin class. It wasn't random, but I was leaving, and he's like, "No, I will drive you home." And I'm like, "Get away from
me." And you were walking home.
Yeah. Yeah.
I will say, you know, now that I have three dogs, it makes me realize how much easier it was to live with dogs in L.A.
Oh, yeah, sure.
I would just open the door, and they would go outside and, you know, do their thing. And now it's like I feel like the difference between two and three dogs is pretty exponential. And I, walking in Manhattan, like in the morning when I walk my dogs, I have three dogs on the leash.
It's and the
I
difference
feel...
between two and three cocktails is the difference between two and three dogs.
It's true.
Two and three martinis has the same effect as two or three
it's
dogs.
True. It's true. It really tips you over the edge.
Tips you over the edge.
And I feel like it's a big a big challenge here in the way it's not.
And you have big dogs.
I have two big dogs.
Yeah, which means, I'm so sorry, but you got to pick up your dog's poop.
Business.
Yeah. Wait, I'll just say one more. So Albert Bianchini, my life partner, and his partner, Kyle Barisich, have this dog named Rufus. And we fight about Rufus a lot because I think they enable Rufus to have very codependent behavior. Like, oh. Rufus is a labradoodle who they will take to the beach and walk him on a leash wearing a life vest. I rest my case, okay?
Seriously?
I'm like, that's a water dog. Anyway, so that's neither here nor there. But Rufus, when he poops, he doesn't stop walking. So he poops and walks. And I watch Kyle with the baggie and I go, Kyle, that's crazy. And he goes, he said, it's hell's Easter egg hunt.
That's what he
said.
Wow.
We had a huge show today. Jeffrey Dean Morgan is here.
Also, Jennifer Morrison.
Yeah.
I love her. Yeah, we've known each other a long time.
Yeah.
I know Jeffrey too.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
You know everybody. That's great.
Exciting.
And we're going to see what happens when the Impractical Jokers took over our merchandise cart. Do you know this show?
Huh?
Do you guys know this show, Impractical Jokers?
Uh-huh.
Okay. So they are hidden camera pranksters son turned me on to.
Uh-huh.
And it's like they send one out into the field, and the other three talk to him and tell him
what to do.
That's and if
great.
He doesn't do it, then there's a punishment.
Oh.
One of them has a Jaden Smith tattoo on his upper thigh. That's as a punishment.
Seriously?
He's a grown man with a teenage Jaden Smith tattoo on his upper thigh. Okay?
That's
so
amazing.
There you go. Turn on here. This is the high point of the show.
Oh, yeah.
I'm gonna cover your vodka.
Oh, yeah.
Your vodka.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, just kidding. It's water. Okay, it's time for Takeoff Travel Trivia.
Did I miss it?
Yeah. You missed it. And we were backstage, and everybody's like,
Wait till
you see the trivia dancer. And you did not disappoint. That's Nathan Groth from Sioux City, Iowa. All right, let's talk to our trivia caller, who is
Sherry Gesserick
from West Columbia, Texas. You can take a hold.
There she is.
Oh,
what?
Oh my,
what's happening there? Is that Moe?
What?
Hi, Sherry.
Good morning.
How's it going? You're not in Texas right now, are you, Sherry?
I am in Texas right now. In that picture, I was in New York. We were celebrating my niece's graduation from NYU.
Oh, fantastic!
I walk through the NYU vibes all the time.
What did she study there?
Yeah.
She went to the Steinhardt School.
Yeah.
Oh, great.
She studied media, culture, and communication.
Uh-oh.
Kendall.
She might be here next week.
Okay, listen, we're going to spin the wheel, see what you're playing for, okay, Sherry? Okay.
What is it?
Okay. Mahikal. Yep, there we go. The Mahikal Beach Resort in Playa del Carmen, Mexico. 7 days, 6 nights. It includes, I butcher the names of these resorts so much that it's like always scary when one comes up.
Mahikal.
Yeah, Mahikal. Uh-huh. A spa treatment per person. This trip is provided in part by hotels.com. It's a prize valued at $5,700. You have 20 seconds and only one guess, Sherry. Good luck.
Amazing. All right, good luck, Sherry. Ben Affleck appeared on the show last week. What did Ben say he bought from the set of his current film?
The Airstream trailer.
That's
right. Congratulations. You and a guest will enjoy 7 days and 6 nights at the Mahikal Beach Resort in Playa del Carmen, Mexico. nestled between the dense Riviera Maya jungle and Playa del Carmen's longest stretch of beach, lies Mexico's Mahikal Beach Resort. The authentic, intimate resort features 196 individual thatched roof bungalow rooms, a Mayan-inspired spa, four swimming pools, a seaside jacuzzi, five restaurants and bars, and more. Your prize is valued at approximately $5,700.
Hey, Sherry, congratulations.
Thank you.
Now you get to help make the day of a lucky member of our studio audience who will receive a $500 appliance package from Cuisinart. Ooh. So please pick a number between 1 and 235.
Number 26.
Live from Once Upon a Time, Jennifer Morrison. The Impractical Jokers take over our merchandise booth. Coming up next, Jeffrey Dean Morgan.
And tomorrow's show, Bryan Cranston will be here.
A lesson in fashion do's and don'ts from Carson Kressley.
Oh, good. And Olympic gold medalist Ali Raisman. Wow.
And Tyler Perry. It's a big show.
Yes.
A lot happening tomorrow.
Now, he broke our hearts last season on The Good Wife and went on to play the baddest.
How you doing, man? Good to see you.
Welcome.
Hello. Hello. So you two know each other.
We do.
We've met.
You've not worked together.
No.
Do you know that I met you once?
Shut your face.
I'm not going to shut my face.
Okay, tell me.
But your husband was like, I think he saw me sitting there for 8 hours kind of waiting for the whole thing to happen.
Yeah.
And kind of like put me under his wing and like showed me around and
He's
introduced
a nice
me
person.
To you. And the two of you were like, I don't know if you want to do this.
We meant it.
Yeah. Like, and I think that I went in by the time...
Save your career.
By the time that the test happened, I think I was like, I don't want to do this.
It happened.
My publicist, as I was walking out, she was like, please don't swear.
It's okay.
It took
we spent the whole segment talking about
30 seconds.
It happens. It's okay.
Well, did you get the job?
I didn't get the job.
You didn't.
I'd probably still be there.
Wait, who were you screen testing for?
It was like some kind of doctor-y guy or something.
I got that job.
I don't remember. But I remember it was kind of a long-term deal and then flying me out to New York. But I was just, you and Mark were so awesome.
Oh, thank you.
And then that's like a year later, I was like doing Grey's Anatomy. So I guess I'm glad it didn't.
It
Come
worked
on.
Out.
Yeah. You're welcome for the career
Thank
advice.
You so much. I do. I owe you, I think.
So, you know, the characters you play run the whole gamut of the fiercely charming and dastardly and rotten and terrifying.
A little bit of both, and sometimes...
Well, sometimes...
Negan's a little bit of both.
Yeah.
He's a little bit charming and a horrible individual all at once.
All at the same time.
Yeah, all at the same time. Yeah. So it's been fun.
Do you feel like people are, I mean, I have this experience having played some pretty psychopathic characters.
Yeah, you've done that.
I mean, does it affect how people relate to you when you run into them in the real world, do you find?
I think that things will shift after the premiere.
Yeah.
Right now, I feel like I'm on my...
Some people love you more.
Yeah, maybe. And that person probably needs to have some psychological help. But I think that there's going to be a little bit of a shift. I think I'm on my last legs of decent will, you know. But we'll see, you know. At the same time, you know, you've done these roles. People are drawn to the
They like
darkness.
The dark.
Yeah,
and
they
pain,
like the dark.
They like pain and suffering.
Yeah.
Well, it's sort of an escape from, you know, people aren't able to bash
really hit people with baseball bats.
In real life,
sure.
So.
You named that bat, right?
Lucille. I mean, Lucille. Yeah.
Oh, the name, you didn't come up with the name. The name
No,
I thought you named.
The show is based on Robert Kirkman's graphic novels,
right.
and Negan is obviously a character that was introduced like 5 years ago through the comic books, and this is a guy that has a baseball bat named Lucille, and Lucille was the name of it at some point.
Right.
Unless you read the comic books,
right,
already know. Yeah.
And you shoot that show in Atlanta.
Golly.
In your leather jacket?
Leather from head to toe.
I mean,
leather underwear. It is.
Are you suffering?
It's a lot.
It's a lot.
It's
right?
a lot. It's a. I mean, Gatorade all day
long.
You
don't have to work out ever.
I'm too old for that anyway. That's a lot of work, that whole working out, getting up at 4 a.m. to do. Yeah, it's hot, and I never take off the leather jacket. And I mean, everybody's kind of in the same boat. You
does
know?
It, can I ask, does it stink at a certain point?
Oh, or to high heaven.
Really?
Oh, more than one?
Yeah.
You must have like a rotation of them.
Right? I have a couple coats, but they're,
once
by the
like
end
the
of it, yeah,
episode,
you're just drenched anyway.
Yeah,
you know, they try to like probably clean them at a certain point. And then again, maybe not, because I'll be covered with like blood, and they don't wash those pants ever. They're like I trying to get them on the next day. It's just,
you are like in your own gravy.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's exactly right. Yeah.
Listen.
It's like a big thing of soup that I wear.
Yeah.
Wow.
We have to take a commercial break. We're going to find out why you love playing a maniac so much.
All right.
With Jeffrey Dean.
Desierto. Tell us about that. You play a character called Sam?
Sam. He is a one-man border patrol wrecking machine. This was written by Jonas Cuaron, who's the co-writer of Gravity. His dad, Alfonso Cuaron, directed Gravity, obviously. And they role-reversed in this one, and Alfonso was our producer. But wrote this movie, and when I read it initially, it reminded me very much, I don't know if you guys remember this movie, Duel, the Steven Spielberg movie. Very much a cat and mouse thriller, and this kind of reminded me of that, set on the border of Texas and Mexico.
Wow.
And I play a real, again, not a good guy, although it, depending on where you are in the country and maybe who you're voting for, you might think he's the most awesome guy in the world.
What does he do?
He kills people trying to cross the border. He kind of snaps and he starts killing people that are trying to cross over from Mexico. Him and his vicious dog, Tracker.
Played by Rocco, man.
Right.
The Bronco is sweet. And then Gael Garcia Bernal, who's awesome, plays the other side of this coin. So we shot it. We shot in Baja, Mexico. And for me, at that time, I'd been doing kind of a lot of good guy roles. This was pre-Negan, you know.
You were still a good wife. Yeah?
This is before Good Wife. We shot this quite, you know. The movie itself premiered not at Toronto this year, the year before.
Oh, my
But
gosh.
What has happened with this political landscape that we find ourselves in they decided they'd hold it back? And
besides the whole political aspect of it all, any other scary encounters in the desert?
You know, it was so hot and miserable that nothing could live out where we were shooting.
Right.
I mean, it was just...
Not even a snake.
Wow. I mean, maybe at nighttime, but we didn't shoot very often at night. But I remember when we were in La Paz, which is kind of at the southern tip of Baja, Mexico, and then we would drive every day for 2.5 hours to the location.
Yeah.
Oof. But by the way, we could have left the hotel and driven 5 minutes and it looks the same. I mean, it was always a mystery to me. Like, why are we driving
two and a half hours
to this crazy location when right outside my hotel window looks exactly the same?
Yeah. That's funny.
I mean, it's really interesting. It's kind of where the desert hits the sea where we shot. It was very kind of picturesque, beautiful place, but it was brutal. So then we'd get to the location and we'd have to hike a mile, and I remember me and Gael like lugging cables and camera equipment up to the set.
You guys were helping out.
Oh yeah, it was hardcore.
A true collaboration.
Yeah. I mean, low budget movie. You know,
everybody's in it together.
I look forward to it.
Which is the best to make.
Totally.
Walking Dead returns October 23rd, and Desierto opens this Friday, October 14th. Make sure you check out Jeffrey Dean Morgan and Desierto.
Coming up, Jennifer Morrison will join us.
So happy to see you.
Tomorrow 101 Live, Tyler Perry. And also Bryan Cranston.
She stars in ABC's Once Upon a Time. Please welcome the lovely Jennifer Morrison. Good to see you. Look so beautiful.
Okay, you are really turning into a princess.
Yeah.
For our eyes. You really
are. I'm trying.
You can't help it.
We mentioned this before. We touched on it. You guys work together, as a matter of fact.
We have. Yes. We've known each other for a long time. Can you believe that was 10 years ago?
Oh, God.
Isn't that crazy?
That's horrifying.
Jennifer was in the first Star Trek film.
Oh, my God.
Kirk's mom.
I gave birth to Chris Pine.
Yeah.
Yes. Hollywood is so cruel. You played his mom.
Right.
That's
in the same
funny
movie.
I married to Chris Hemsworth and gave birth to Chris Pine. I was like, I'll take it.
Yeah. Now, so this is very interesting to me. I heard, and I don't know if this has anything to do with the role you're playing, but you've been to Disney World 35.
Disney Vacation.
It's probably significantly more than that.
From what age? And like in the same place?
I think it started in the womb.
Okay.
It was really sort of just like research to play Emma Swan. Right. I just didn't know it. Mm-hmm. My parents really love it. They just love being in Disney World.
It's magical.
Yeah. And so we lived in Chicago and we would load up in the Dodge Ram van, maroon Dodge Ram van. And we'd drive down there. It's like a 21-hour drive. It was a whole thing, and we had.
Would you drive straight through?
Sometimes, yeah. And we had the cooler, you know, where I'd have to make the sandwiches to keep the driver driving.
Yeah.
And then we'd stop at, I think it was Hardee's, where it's 5 for five, or Arby's. Yeah. Arby's, five for five.
That's what it was. Right.
Do you have siblings?
Yeah, I'm the oldest of three. I have a sister.
So you would all pack into the car.
Yeah. And so we'd go like 3 times a year.
Oh my gosh.
It was really, it was so sweet because, you know, it's like my parents just wanted us to have something so special to look forward to. They knew we were.
And did you always go to Disney World in Orlando?
Yeah. Yeah. Now it's become Disneyland because I live in Los Angeles.
So you still go.
But do you take your family with you?
Well, now it's a very different experience.
I would think so.
Yeah.
I mean.
Well, now I can only go when, like, they're, like, scooting me back behind. Like,
you know,
it's kind of the craziest place to take Emma Swan. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, like, yeah. It's like, like, when you show up there and you're standing there, do the birds come down?
People know where I am because I just have animals like following me.
Deer. Oh, she's over there. She's this way.
Yeah. It's it's pretty crazy because people think I'm kind of there to be a character at Disneyland, you know.
She looks so real in person.
Yeah.
Well, so with all, like, speaking of characters, like, all, you know, the princesses and the world and Halloween's coming out.
Yes.
So does this translate for you into, are you a big Halloween person?
I have mixed feelings about Halloween because I dress up to be someone else every day, which I'm sure you know.
Right.
You understand. But Jennifer Goodwin is way into Halloween. Uh-huh. And the first season, she went out of her way to get all of us really, really good Harry Potter outfits.
Huh.
Like, the real deal. Yeah, there. Oh. See? The scarf, the cape.
That's crazy. I can't believe that ABC let that happen.
I don't know that we let them know about it.
Yeah,
but so basically, I can't live up to the quality of outfit that she pulled off. So I just play Hermione every year at Halloween.
Just do it every
year. It's a good costume.
Hermione's about to make her 6th appearance.
Oh. Good. All right. That's
everybody
great.
Else has moved on from Harry Potter, but
you're but I'm still,
Break.
Up next, we'll be right back, and we're going to find out if Emma Swan is going to live happily ever after.
Oh, my God.
That looked intense.
I feel like I'm always crashing into things.
What happened?
Yeah.
Someone doesn't want us to leave town.
But obviously.
Yeah. That's what happens. You put up a protection spell that makes you bounce off an energy field.
What's going on with you and Captain Hook?
So many fun things. We're about to move in together.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Be careful of that plank.
So excited. But also, I understand your character's starting to have some visions, some
premonitions. Yes, she I just realized how silly it sounds talking about this. Yeah. Like, I have visions, there's force fields, I'm dating Captain Hook. Emma has started having these flashes of her future where she sees herself die.
Oof.
So,
that's never good.
I have that constantly.
It will happen to all of us at some point, I suppose. But she's scared to tell her family because obviously she feels like there's going to be this huge domino effect of everybody being afraid, and we already have all these other problems going on.
Do you think that means your character's going to die? Did they tell you anything? What can you tell us? They need to know.
I can't tell you. Oh, I'm sorry. I know. I don't know. I think, you know, a lot of the season is her facing almost her post-traumatic stress of everything that's mm-hmm. happened. She went from being kind of a normal person to she has fairy tale family. She's saving the world. She's fighting dragons. You know, it's like all these things happen. She's never dealt with it. Yeah. So, and now she's having these visions of possibly dying in the future.
So it's safe to say there's a lot to look forward to.
Yes. She's... And next time you come back, I want to talk about your film because you just directed
I directed a film called Sundogs, and I'm in the post-production process right now. But I'm very proud of it. Michael Ungerano, Melissa Benoist, Ed O'Neill, and Allison Janney, star in the film.
That's great. Awesome.
And they're just all so wonderful. They give beautiful, beautiful performances. And we're just in the process of refining and polishing and trying to.
So get you'll it all come together. Back when that comes.
I
out?
Would love
okay.
to.
That'd Super. Be awesome. So here we are in the lobby of our studio on 67th Street. Every morning, you guys already know that you line up here. We put you through a metal detector, and then you come right here, and this is so quintessentially us. We put you right in front of the merchandise booth.
I'm rating
which,
merchandise.
Yeah, no, take whatever you want. No, take whatever you want.
So I might, you know.
Some unsuspecting members of our studio audience had encounters with the Impractical Joker. So let's take a look at what happened when Murr became our live merchandise salesman.
This person, whatever she wants to buy, offer to sell at a discount round back.
Hi, how are you?
Good.
Welcome to Live with Kelly. How are you?
Good.
Okay, this is our merch table. Okay. Now, all this stuff is generally, you know, between $15 and $30.
Okay.
But I can sell you it at a discount round back.
After the show.
Is that allowed?
I can't.
What are you, a square?
Are you a square? What's up?
I'm not a square.
What are you, a snitch? You cop? What are you?
You cop? You have to tell me.
If you're a cop, you have to tell me. That's a law.
What do you got?
Let me see.
What do you mean?
Let's see. We'll see how much you got. Remember, price fluctuates on demand.
Oh, really?
Let's just put the mug right in a purse.
Are you going to... Oh, my goodness.
Hold that for me.
Try again.
No, I don't want to play.
No, you a square? You a cop? You gotta tell me. You snitching.
Say I'm on break. I'm on break.
You like hugging people, right?
Who doesn't?
Oh, I didn't mention. Don't let go.
Welcome to Live with Kelly. Hi, how are you? Hi.
Oh, I get a big. Oh, that's a good
dinner. Bring the other one in. Bring her in for group hug.
You guys want some merch? What do you want?
I'm sorry. Did I say hello?
How rude of me!
T-shirts. I'm a hugger.
I'm sorry, I'm a hugger.
Bring it in.
I'm bringing it in. Come on.
No, I didn't know that line is so long.
Uh-oh. Uh-oh, do you hear that?
Uh-oh.
What time
do you hear that?
You hear what time it is? Dance party! You can't stop. Hey, one more.
They're taking pictures.
Stop it. Hug him.
We're just having fun.
This one here.
Sure.
What size do they come in?
Okay, well, we have an assortment of sizes. Let me show you.
Ask her to hold a pile of shirts.
Let me... Hold on. Just one second.
Keep going. Get in a pile of shirts.
Okay. One second.
Go.
These are not the gray ones.
No, those are not the gray ones.
What size did you want? Mostly, you're looking for.
Do I need more?
What's that? One second. I'm trying to find out. You're dropping the shirts.
She's got to pay for every single one.
You got to pay for anything you drop.
What about a hat?
Yeah, we can get that on you.
Do they have socks by chance?
I don't think we have socks. The blue hats are brand new. You're going to love those.
Ask her if she wants to be in the raffle.
Do you want to be in the raffle?
I have a raffle jar.
We have a raffle jar. Here, fill this out.
Let me take that.
Oh, thank you, sir.
Get him to hold him.
Oh, do you mind hold this for 1 second? Yeah. Thank you so much.
Take it from her arms right to his arms.
She's trying to fill out the wrap. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Everything you drop, sir, you have to pay for.
Sir, anything you drop, you have to pay for.
Just pour some of the water into the mug. Now, when they come over, I want you to put your hand in it, get stuck, and just start waving around and splash water all over the place.
What the heck? I can't get out. What the heck? I can't get it. My hand is stuck. Oh,
there you go, second mug.
I didn't think.
So you see what happened is I put my hand right there.
Here's what happened. I put my hand. Oh, no. I put my hand in. Come out.
All right, now try and help her with mug hands.
We have these great new blue T-shirts. Try those. Here.
Get her a pen.
Here, let me get you a pen, too. The pens are great. No, I'm just watching. Don't help me.
Pick up a pen.
Put as many hats as you can on top of her.
Here. Well, where's all the hats? Okay.
That's a camera. The top one's a camera. You just click.
Oh.
That's a camera.
There's nothing to worry about. Stop cursing.
Sorry. Well, this camera's shot. Hold on, let me turn it over. Jeez. Hold on 1 second. I'm trying to adjust our hidden cameras. See, I'm not a real employee. They're telling me things to do. I pulled one of the cameras like an idiot, like it's season one of my TV show. Put it on your head. There goes the camera.
You're doubling down on it.
She's enjoying it.
Say hello to the hidden camera.
Hi, hidden camera.
Don't you love them? They're great.
They're great.
Spectacular. It airs November 3rd at 8 p.m. on True TV from the Prudential Center in Newark. For tickets, you can go to our website. I'm definitely going to take my kids to see that. And we will be right back, everybody.
If you'd like to know more about anything you see on Live, visit livekelly.com.
We don't want to forget to remind everyone to tune in Wednesday to see the top 10 semifinalists that you voted for in Live's Kelly and you co-host search. So we're still doing that, so don't forget to tune in for that. And I want to thank you. You are so fun today.
It was a blast. Thank you for having me. Thank you. This is Rocco.
And
Rocco was adopted here on this show through Muddy Paws Rescue, which is an incredible rescue organization. They bring dogs up from the South primarily and then find them homes here in the city. So Rocco's from Alabama.
And adopt.
Adopt
if you're looking
dogs.
For a pet, adopt your pet. Right? Please.
Right, Rocco?
Right? You're a baby. Cranston will be here.
Olympic gold medalist Allie Raisman.
Raisman. Carson Kressley will be here. And Tyler Perry will be here as well.